gonna take a sentimental journey. Gonna set my heart at ease. Gonna make a sentimental journey.
Hello. Willkommen, or welcome. This is the German-American television magazine, Chapter 2, brought to you by the German-American Heritage Foundation International, based here in the greater Detroit area. And I'm Gene Strobel, your host for this program and the producer. I'm also the founding president of the Heritage Foundation. We present this program each week as a public service to the people of Greater Detroit. As we hope will be usual, we have a guest on our program, at least one guest each week, sometimes two, as we did last week. Today, I have a real special pleasure to have my partner in our various projects over the years, and that's Germaine Strobel, who is my wife, and I think she's willing to admit it publicly. But also, she is a founding officer of the foundation. By the way, just for brevity's sake, we often give the acronym for the foundation as GAFI. So if you hear the word GAFI from time to time, no, it is not the leader of Libya, but it is the German-American Heritage Foundation International, pronounced more or less the German way. Our program is going to be conducted pretty much in the English language. The exceptions to that would be an occasional phrase or word, particularly toward the end of the program. We will have more and more a little German conversation lesson. And today's program will have a few words, a few phrases at toward the end, but we won't get into our German conversation lesson until perhaps next week in a little heavier way. But even then, it's only a matter of 3 or 4 minutes. So you'll be listening mostly to the English language as we use our Midwest dialect here. Most of the music that we use will be vocal music, and in that case, for the most part, the music will be in German. Today, however, there will be a bit of an exception because we are going to discuss one of the great showbiz personalities here in the United States, and even though her roots were German, she certainly was the all-American girl and sung, at least in her showbiz career, in the English language. But whether we use English or German, I hope that you enjoy the program. And Germaine is going to help bring this program to you today. One of the regular features on our program will be to refer to some of the key dates in German and German-American history. This will involve our heritage both in Europe, principally, in the German-speaking countries and cultures, as well as here in North America in terms of German-American heritage in its broad sense. And what we do in that regard is we refer to our German-American heritage calendar. And I have one here, as we did last week. I introduced this particular reference tool. But we will use it at each program because I think it's astounding the kinds of events and personalities which have been a part of German-American history and part of the American mainstream at the same time. And Germaine and I are going to just do a little bit of lifting from the first 13 days in April. Let's make it the first 12 days, just to be on the safe side, Germaine, not
okay.
Get into any unlucky numbers here.
Right.
And we will show you what we have in this calendar, because not only is it interesting, we hope, but there are even some amusing little points of history from time to time as well. So we're going to start off with April 1st, April Fool's Day, which, of course, this year was also Passover. And it was on April 1st, back in 1789, that Frederick Muhlenberg was elected the first Speaker of the U.S. House of Representatives. And, of course, he came from German-American roots, and it was a great honor that this particular ethnic group had such a man of distinction in the first government of the United States following the Revolutionary War. born in 1815, was Otto Bismarck, the so-called Iron Chancellor, who then united Germany as the Second Reich under Prussian rule. So that's when Prussia then became the leading element of the United German States. Now, Germaine will give us what happened on April 2nd.
April 2nd, born in 1875, skilled mechanic Walter Chrysler, or Greisler, formed one of United States' big three auto firms, known for quality engineering. The firm was bought by Daimler-Benz of Stuttgart, Germany, in 1998.
Yeah, so just about 1 year old, the new firm. Okay, the 3rd of April, born in 1924, singer, actress Doris Koppelhoff, we know her better as Doris Day, rose to top stardom in Hollywood. We're going to talk about Doris Day. I had mentioned her before as kind of our star celebrity from history and from the current scene, which will be the next segment of this program. Well, born in 1930, Helmut Kohl, the four-term chancellor who reunited East with West Germany as a republic of the Federal Republic of Germany as we know it today. Back in 1948, U.S. President Truman signed the European Marshall Plan, which helped European recovery, particularly of Germany and its neighboring states.
On April 4th, it was Easter. Yeah. And daylight savings time begins.
Yes.
Or began, I should say. And apparently there were no Germans born.
Nothing happened on the 4th of April.
We'll
do some more research on that one.
Yeah. We should find something.
Yeah. April 5th, born in 1840, botanist Matthias Schleiden co-formulated the cell theory, the basis of modern-day science. Born in 1908, Austrian conductor Herbert von Karajan directed the world's best orchestras, namely the Vienna and Berlin Symphonic Orchestras. I might add at this point that on October 20th, the Berlin Symphony Orchestra, which many consider as perhaps the best in the world at this time, will be coming to Ann Arbor, Michigan for a concert. Well, there'll be a lot more about that as we go along. Okay.
On the 6th, in 1917, the United States declared war on Germany and Austria to bring World War I to faster Allied victory in 1918. Later, the Nazis used the defeat and harsh Treaty of Versailles to take power.
April 7th, in 1862, German-American units led by Colonel Auguste Willich fought with courage and distinction at Shiloh, one of the Civil War's major and bloodiest battles.
On the 8th, born in 1732, astronomer David Rittenhouse made the first telescope in the English colonies. And also on that date, born in 1805, German botanist Hugo von Moll was first to identify protoplasm.
Now you see how this goes. We're actually doing a little bit more of this program because we're catching up to April. We didn't do this last week, but we have a few more events and dates here. On the 9th of April, back in 1865, the German inventor Siegfried Marcus was born, and he was the first one to operate what he called a Kraftwagen, an actual motor vehicle, the first car on the streets of Vienna. In 1919 was born John Eckert, who built the first commercial computer.
On the 10th, born in 1835, German publisher Henry Villard Hilgard built Northern Pacific Railroad and General Electric Company. Born in 1847, Hungarian Josef Pulitzer edited St. Louis's German newspaper and also founded the Post-Dispatch. In 1978, Volkswagen opened its first U.S. car plant.
April 11th, born in 1721, Moravian missionary David Zeisberger. He established two Christian Indian towns of Schönbrunn and the first European settlement in Ohio, and Gnadenhütten, also in Ohio.
Gnadenhutten. Remember that. Okay. Yeah. On the 12th, born in 1884, German Otto Meyerhoff won the 1922 Nobel Prize for lactic acid and its effect on muscle contraction. In 1945, President Franklin Roosevelt died as World War II victory neared. And in 1996, rebuilt for $800 million, the Leipzig Trade Center opened.
As you can see, this particular reference tool, the German-American Heritage Calendar, is definitely loaded with factoids or historical facts. And one could say these are trivia, but when you talk about Nobel Prize winner or the founder of General Motors, or rather General Electric, or Chrysler, these obviously are not trivial events in American or German-American history. If you're interested in acquiring one of these calendars, there's going to be a telephone number and address at the end of the program in the credit roll. And for any of these items that we do on the program, you can certainly give us a call or drop us a line, and we'll let you know how you can get a hold of it later on. Well, we mentioned Doris Day, who was born in the Kappelhoff family 75 years ago in the very, very German city of Cincinnati at that time. And we would like to dedicate the first part of the program to her in terms of her great artistry over the years and her very special personality and charm, which lit up the screen and stage as she performed. We're going to be using some excerpts. Germaine is going to be reading some excerpts, very brief ones, from her book, which is the autobiography. It's entitled Doris Day, and the subtitle is Her Own Story, with the help of A.E. Hotchkiss, who was...
Hotchner, dear.
Sorry, Hotchner. Can't read upside down that well. Mr. Hotchner, of course, assisted Doris Day in this very fine autobiography. It was published back, was it 1985, Germaine?
1975.
Okay, yeah. Copyright 1975, so that we're not going to be dealing with the more recent events in her life, obviously, since 1975, but with her childhood, particularly her German roots in her favorite town of Cincinnati, Ohio. And as a way of introducing her own words through the pen of Mr. Hotchner, I think it's interesting that at the very outset of the book, kind of the theme was a very famous song of hers, Que Sera Sera, perhaps one that's most identified with her brilliant career. And I just want to read just a little bit of the lyrics as a lead-in to Germaine's excerpts from her autobiography, because it really is a theme that I think characterizes her years,
philosophy.
Both sat and philosophy, yes, both the happy part and the poignant parts of her life. And you'll recognize these words, of course, because you hear them so often on the Golden Oldies programs.
My roots in Cincinnati go very deep. I didn't leave there wanting to escape to someplace better. I only left because the tide of events washed me away. And often, an ebb tide of misfortune brought me back. I could have happily lived in my entire life in Cincinnati, married to a proper Cincinnatian, living in a big old Victorian house, raising a brood of offspring. But preordination, which I sincerely believe in, had other plans for me. As far as I am concerned, whatever we will be, where we go, and what we do with our lives is locked into us from birth. My predestination was to wander around for a while on bumpy band buses, singing at one-night stands before coming to roost in Hollywood. But to this day, curiously, I am less emotionally attached to Los Angeles, where I lived for 27 years, than I am to Cincinnati. I was born Doris Kappelhoff, named by my mother in honor of her favorite movie actress, Doris Kenyon, a silent screen star of that year, 1924. My parents lived at Greenlawn and Jonathan Streets in a red brick two-family house in Evanston, a moderate income Cincinnati suburb. I was born in that house, attended by a good German midwife, as my two brothers had been before me. My father, William, was a music teacher, primarily piano, and choral master, while my mother, Alma Sophia, was a true Hausfrau. Both my parents were born in downtown Cincinnati, but their parents were German immigrants. My mother's father came from Berlin. His family was quite wealthy, but he ran into trouble when he refused to join the German army on the grounds that he didn't believe in military activity. There was no war then, but he refused to become a part of any military buildup that might lead to war. So he left Germany, forsaking the lucrative family business. He came to Cincinnati, where there was a large German community, and he opened a pretzel factory, the heavy, thick pretzels that are soft and covered with salt. My grandmother and all their many children, including my mother, worked in the pretzel factory, and my mother's brothers sold pretzels on the street corners all over Cincinnati. A big bag of pretzels slung over their shoulders, five for a nickel. Five times heavier than donuts, but absolutely delicious. With the profits from his pretzel factory, my grandfather bought a building, the downstairs of which he converted into a big bakery and dining room. The family lived in the apartments above the bakery. Word came to my grandfather that his mother in Berlin was dying, so he made a hurried trip to try to reach her before she died. But his sister, on finding out that he was coming, notified the military authorities. After all those years, she still wanted to turn him in for having dodged the draft. My grandfather got wind of it, however, and as the police came barging in the front door of the Berlin house, my grandfather escaped through a rear window. But he never got to see his mother, nor did he get his inheritance. It went to the German government.
You know, Germaine, if I can interrupt at this point, this kind of derring do and spunkiness was very much a part of Doris Day's personality.
Yes.
Not only in her personal life, but also in her professional life.
Yes.
And so whether it was a genetic thing here or just a family legend that influenced her,
no.
I really think that this is a good incident from her ancestry, which probably built into her own character.
I'm sure it influenced her life.
Throughout her life, yeah.
Can I go on, dear?
Yes.
Yes. Now, my grandmother was something else. She was adorable. After her husband's death, she ran the bakery, raised all those kids, and managed to enjoy her life. Mama Welts. Welts, I guess in German. She retired from the bakery when she was in her late 50s, turned it over to her sons, and she came to live with us in the house in Evanston. She died when I was 10. I don't know much about my father's parents, but as for my own parents, from my earliest memory of the relationship that existed between them, I knew that they were not, in the scheme of things, intended for each other. It was an ill-matched, ill-fated marriage from the word go. No two people were ever more opposite. My mother is very barrel house, loves to yak it up and enjoy herself, loves parties, and the more people around her, the better. She loves country western hillbilly music. She could listen to country and western all day long. All through my career, she asked me, when are you going to make a country and western movie? My father was the other side of that coin. He was an introverted, quiet man who loved classics and adored listening to opera. What battles they had over music. My father would get a concert on the radio and settle back to enjoy it. My mother's ears were actually offended by classical music, especially opera. So after enduring the music as long as she could, she would march over and flip the dial to some good old hillbilly music. A few minutes later, my father was at the radio getting back to the symphony or opera. This musical tug of war never ceased, but their musical altercations were just symptomatic of their entire relationship. My father was a handsome man, tall, slender, thick auburn hair, large brown eyes, topped by heavy auburn eyebrows. He dressed elegantly, and as a girl, I was very proud of his looks. Everyone called him Professor, although of course he wasn't, and I recall how pleased I was to walk to church with him in his fine clothes and elegant ways, and to hear him greeted as Professor Koppelhoff as we made our way up the church steps. My father's whole life was music. As a boy, he shunned sports and other boyhood distractions, using all his spare time to practice. At 16, he was an organist for a Catholic church. By the time he married my mother, he was a well-established teacher of piano and violin and a respected choral master. He gave lessons in our house and also the houses of his pupils. Evenings were invariably devoted to various German Gesangverein, choral societies, with which Cincinnati abounded. Cincinnati was then predominantly German, and since Germans loved to sing, these big choral groups with as many as 400 or 500 voices flourished. Once a year, they would have their big recital, and my father was the city's most sought-after conductor. I remember once going to watch him conduct a choral group that was singing with the Cincinnati Symphony. He got incredible performances out of these amateur groups. My father tried to get both my brother and me interested in playing the piano, and he gave us some lessons, but he finally gave up on me because I wouldn't practice. First of all, I was interested in popular music, not the Chopin and Mozart that he taught. And secondly, my overriding love was dancing. When my father had a little free time to give me a lesson, I was invariably at dancing school.
Well, we have a few pictures from her autobiography to illustrate the words you were saying, Germaine. And just to kind of wrap things up, of course, dancing never came to be the main professional line for Doris Day because of an auto accident. Her family car was hit by a train, and she was very seriously injured to the point where they thought she would not walk again. So at age 13, it seemed like her life was just practically over. She did recover from that to the point where she began to, as a professional singer instead of dancing.
That's right.
At age 16. And then later on in her career, in some of the films, she did dance and beautifully, though perhaps not quite the level she had hoped to do.
It's interesting, since she talked so much about predestination,
right,
how she believed in it, right, that she actually, that this incident would happen to her that led her life in an entirely different direction.
We have a wonderful souvenir here. Germaine and I were out in California a few months ago. And at that time, we visited the beautiful resort town of Carmel in California, where Doris Day has a beautiful hotel, a resort hotel, called the Cypress Inn. And at that time, we met her one son, Terry Melcher, who was very, very pleasant to us, and we talked about some possibilities of doing projects together. So as we sign off here and say so long, we want to listen to another song, this time by Doris Day, as we roll out. Thank you very much, and see you next week.
Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, land that I heard of once in a lullaby. Melt like lemon drops away above the chimney.